A dust particle from the World Trade Center from Jeanette McKinley's sample, and we see. I showed this. Nothing up my sleeve. Nothing. Ah, magician. Nothing up my sleeve, Willie. There is nothing. No, this is science. Anyway, I showed this to Doug Rocky last night. He got teary-eyed looking at this. I'll let you describe some implications, Doug, if you would. But anyway, look, iron, this is the sulfur peak, folks. It's off scale, or nearly, because they scale it, but it goes almost out. Aluminum, we see copper as well. So we can tell you what they put in the thermate. These data, hot off the press, last Wednesday, okay? Iron oxide, aluminum powder, copper oxide, and if you look, here's another plot, another spot shows potassium permanganate. I can tell you what they put in there. Now let's let Doug comment, if you would, Doug.
When we saw the data, now I knew about this already, but when I saw the data last night, it was very readily obvious. Willie, where are you at? Okay, Willie, you and my friends in the emergency services unit, as you were in the floors, what did you hear, sir?
I heard explosions, and I had this horrible smell that got stuck on my throat.
What was the smell?
I'm going to repeat. What did you smell?
It was like ammonium and sulfur that stuck on my throat, and I did make a comment on television 5 days after because they asked me. That was September 15 or 16 on television, national television in Spanish, and I'm talking about this acrid smoke.
Where's David? David, in 911 in plain sight, you specifically talked to and have on camera members of the New York Police and Fire Department, and what specifically did they state?
Okay, I don't want to misspeak. Some of the footage that is in plain sight came from television networks, and as far as the firefighters are concerned, there were lots of folks that said that they felt that they were choking, although I don't have the description like Willie has, you know, an acrid smell, sulfur, et cetera, et cetera. But the overwhelming majority of the people that we review the videotape, some of it went into the project, some of it didn't, basically saying the same thing. They were choking, they couldn't, you know, they get into the lungs and then they can't breathe.
There are a video out there where they have the police and the fire, and the guys are saying it was explosions going off 4x4, bang, 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 bang. The implications. We have a building in freefall. We have a building with a massive steel structure, both externally and internally. If you look at an automobile today, you will know, and it's bragged about, that automobile.
Well, welcome to Take Back America live this Wednesday, the 24th of February, with just 5 days left in the month. Unless Congress decides to add another 30, 40 days to February just because they think they can. Taking off my white hat for you people who tuned in today or to the repeat of the show, a great friend of the Jackson family, the majestic, the magnificent, has had his final viewing last night, Tuesday, at Tillman Mortuary in Riverside on 10th Street, and yours truly was there. LaToya Jackson showed up, Jermaine Jackson showed up, and the viewing room was pretty much full for the man we knew as Majestic the Magnificent. He was a card shark and into magic tricks. And he did a few stints in Las Vegas, and that's what he liked to do. But he was born Harry Lloyd Wright back in July of 1955. Passed away about 3 a.m. on the 19th of this February, this month. And we all said our goodbyes, and he did his last magic trick, disappearing It was just really uncanny and unusual. I was not used to seeing Majestic without his great big smile and all his teeth showing and his loud booming voice. And he could be very soft voice, but you knew he was in the room. I never knew his name was Harry Lloyd Wright, and he probably wouldn't want us to share that. He wanted to be remembered, and I believe legally changed his name to Majestic the Magnificent. We have a few photos. Take a look at one of those from the funeral home. It was a sad affair. There is a son with an image of Majestic behind her with her manager. His brother said he didn't want pictures of Majestic in the casket for fear it might be misused. There's another one, that big head, that's Majestic in Better Days. And I didn't know, but he had served in the United States Army. He was a veteran. And son was brought to an event that I did in 2011 by Majestic, and she's got a golden voice. She's got her songs ready to go on a DVD, but we haven't heard them yet. I thought it is fitting for us to take a minute because when Michael Jackson was under his most horrific attacks in Korea in 2005 by a malicious team of prosecutors by the name of Thomas Snedden Jr., Gordy Auchincloss, and Ronald Zonin, oh, and that little peepsqueak Magna Cola, who screwed up the one half day he got to present fake and phonied up phone evidence. Good thing. The jury saw it. That trial has left an indelible mark on my mind. I have never seen a prosecutor work so hard to create fake and absolutely felonious evidence and present it as if it's white as snow, as if it's the absolute God's truth. And it was all turned out to be absolute shice, absolute crap. No truth came out of Snedden, Zonin, or Auchincloss's mouth about Michael. In fact, the trial was so bad, and this is what Majestic, you know, he was there for the Jacksons. He was almost like a family member to the Jacksons. I never knew he had an older brother. Met him last night for the first time. Majestic passed away in Moreno Valley at his home. He didn't have very much when he left this world. He didn't have very much when he came into this world. But a lot of Michael Jackson fans and some of his own fans came. One named Debbie came all the way from Rome, got on a nonstop flight the day before on Monday after seeing my announcement on my Facebook. And she flew to represent herself and her mother, who consider themselves really close friends to Michael. Imagine flying from Rome, Italy, to Los Angeles, California, to see a man in his last few hours before they closed and locked the casket for burial, where he will be buried now. I guess he's in transportation in Arkansas. Majestic the Magnificent will do his disappearing act, and we won't see him again. But he was ferocious in defending Michael. He was always a friend to Joe Jackson and defending Joe. Here's another image from the Tillman Mortuary in Riverside. So that's Majestic. Now, I want to bring your attention before we go to Charlie Grebsky and go to Sheriff Mack. Sheriff Mack said some wonderful things about the ranchers and farmers up in Oregon that are being just pounded on because they don't want to sell their ranch to the federal government or the BLM or anybody else. And in fact, the BLM doesn't own this public land. But they're trying to, as they did in Bunkerville, Nevada in April of 2014 when they lost that battle to the Bundys, they're trying to claim all the public land as federal land, and then we'll see it turned over piecemeal to foreign countries for their exploitation. But we're not ready to go to that. I want to read you. I just got a letter back from Daryl D. Parker from the historic courthouse in Santa Barbara on Anacapa Street. I wrote him a letter. I had some questions. Most of you don't know this, and you should know this. You should know this. When you're arrested, whether it's a traffic ticket that you refuse to sign, he says, well, I'm going to arrest you then and take you to jail. You have an absolute constitutional right to say, I want to see a magistrate immediately. And the police officer, by law, though they don't teach them this, So the cops don't know this, and they don't want you to know this. But by law, he is required to take you in front of a magistrate, and he has to tell the magistrate why your being arrested is justified. He has to tell the magistrate immediately, not a day later, not you're picked up on a Friday night and you see the judge on Monday morning. No, you have a right to see the magistrate immediately. How many of we the people know that? Do they tell you that on the corporate media? No, they don't. So anyway, I sent a list of questions to the presiding judge at the time, last December, and he had Daryl E. Parker, who is the, most of you won't know who that is, he's the executive who runs the courthouses in Santa Barbara. I think his technical title is court executive officer. I asked him a set of questions. One is, how many judges do you usually assign for prompt probable cause? That's a PC hearing, probable cause hearings on a daily basis when court is not in session, like after 5 p.m. and often after 3:30, there's no judges around. They all go off to the golf course or home to lunch or whatever they do. So that was my question. After 5 p.m., his answer was this. There are two judges on call and two assigned as backups. One judge and one backup are assigned to the North and the South County, respectively. He means Santa Barbara County. I have never seen one of these judges for probable cause hearing. And if you know of anybody who's been arrested after 5 p.m. and he demanded his probable cause hearing, call me. 928-1100. Call me. I want to know who the judge was and what the circumstances was. No, usually they just lock you up in the jail and make you wait days and days. But you have an absolute right for a probable cause hearing immediately, not in a few days when the judge is back from vacation or whatever. You have a right to that hearing immediately. His answer was, as I told you, there are two. I've never seen them. And supposedly this answer says, and there are backups in case that one's not available. I've never seen them. They may assign them, but I've never heard of them. Second question I asked him, this is back in December. He mentions my letter was December 21st. How often does someone actually see a judge before they are detained? Answer, probable cause statements are submitted by the arresting officer and reviewed by a judge within 24 hours. I've never seen that either. This process occurs using the written documents. How do you get your appearance if you're not physically there because you're sitting down in a jail? There is not an appearance of a detainee during the probable cause determination. Really? I think the law is you have to give them that appearance, but they don't. The statements are reviewed to determine that there is a reasonable ground in the facts and circumstances for a belief that the defendant committed the crime. If there is no probable cause, judge will have the defendant released from custody. Like within 24 hours? No, you have a right to the probable cause hearing immediately. Immediately. It's not 24 hours later. And you have a right to see that judge personally. Because what facts is he going to go by? Just the facts the police wrote down? We know in the Kelly Thomas murder where those two cops, Cincinnati Morales or whatever his name was, Cincinnati and the other guy, they beat him to death on tape, then wrote a bunch of lies, submitted their report. When they found out that the bus terminal in Fullerton, California had caught it all on video, they had to take back their statement and rearrange it. Why was that? Did they lie in writing and their official police report? Just throwing the question out there. You should be able to confront in front of the judge at the probable cause hearing what the cop says is facts and give the judge your side. What he's telling us is that the judge just goes by what the cop says, period. Third question is, do you increase the number when there is a higher number of expected arrests? Answer, no. Question four, how many judges did you assign for the Halloween weekend of Isla Vista in 2015? Answer, the normal complement of judicial officers were assigned. Now there's one for North County and one for the Isla Vista fiasco. Now don't get me wrong, I think they need to have those police officers. I don't want to see Hollywood producers' sons driving up and drunkenly slaughtering and running down four or five people just because he feels like it. And he did get off pretty easy, didn't he? He never did any hard time because he was the son of a Hollywood producer. Maybe Ron Zonin could enlighten us a little more on how that worked. Question five. Was there an increase in the number of judges assigned for probable cause hearings because of UCSB had more police officers for that weekend and there was a likelihood of more arrests? Answer, no. Question six, how many probable cause hearings have there been since January 1 of 2015? Remember, I wrote these questions in December of 2015. Answer, we don't track this data. That's what he wrote. Now, wait a minute. They track the total number of arrests, druggies and whatnot. They track the number of people who are in jail any given day. They have to because they have to provide meals for them, so they have to account for them. But the probable cause hearings, which for all practical purpose for the detainee, is done in secret because only a judge, allegedly, reviews the facts of the police report, allegedly. That's shocking. We don't track this data? Question seven, how many of these hearings have there been since January 1, 2015, just on weekends? Answer, we don't track that data. How often was a probable cause found and not found during these hearings? Answer, we don't track this data. Question nine, I want to see the judges assigned for the weekend since January 1 of 2015. Answer, information used to make assignments is exempt from California rules of court. I don't care if it's exempt from the rules of court under 10.500. I want to see the list. Certainly you keep a list, Mr. Parker. Number 10, what policy is in place about these types of hearings? Answer, the California Penal Code governs probable cause determinations. Signed respectfully, Daryl E. Parker. I thank you, Mr. Parker, for answering the letter, even if it took December, January, almost 6 weeks to answer this letter. But I thank you. I think you should start tracking who the probable cause judges are, because that way we could check to see if they were on vacation when they were supposed to be looking at these documents. I have a hunch nobody looks at them. And the first time we see or hear or know anything about it is when the defendant shows up for his arraignment and it's presumed probable cause was found. The Constitution was written to protect we the people from an abusive government. It wasn't written to give the government all the power and control. And when the court system of Santa Barbara, or for that matter, any county, can say is, we don't track this data, really? You have a case file on every case that started. Starts with an arrest, you have a probable cause. Then you have an arraignment. You got the arraignment date and the minutes of the arraignment hearing. You know, you got all that. You should have a probable cause hearing where the detainee or the arrestee gets to appear, even with or without an attorney, and say something to contradict what the police officers say. Because as we all know, sometimes the police officers have a very skewered view of the facts, seen only from the police officer's point of view. And this is dangerous for America. This is really dangerous. You have a right, if you're stopped, even for a traffic ticket, and you refuse to sign the traffic ticket, or you sign it signed under duress, you have a right if you don't sign it. And he says, I'm going to take you and put you in jail if you don't sign the traffic ticket. You have a right to say, take me to the magistrate. I want my probable cause hearing now, please, Mr. Officer. They don't do that. Never heard of them doing that. Okay, with that said, there is a case that has everything to do with probable cause, and I put in a media request. It's a case of the people of California versus Brandon Morris, a college student down in Isla Vista. Now, I didn't go to the Halloween party and don't particularly want to. My college days are way, way behind me, and even then I didn't side with the rabble-rousers. If anything, I was more for law enforcement. But that said, I think Brandon Morris may have been wrongfully dealt with because he was just taping the cops at their detention center out on the street. And some kind of a incident then came, and they haven't given him his tape back yet. How many months does it take the police officers to simply make a copy, I'm talking about the sheriff's deputies, make a copy of his tape and give him his original back? Maybe the tape will reveal something. Anyway, I put in a media request, and Judge Brian Hill, who's been on this show when he was running for judge, I interviewed him. Judge Hill initially said, I'm going to approve this. I don't see any objection to it. And then the prosecutors from the crooked Santa Barbara District Attorney's Office said, oh, we object. He's just a blogger. Well, if I'm just a blogger, I'm told this, I wasn't there. If I'm just a blogger, why are you watching me now on television? Bloggers don't go on live television. No, I understand the DA's position to keep as much secret and keep the people ignorant so we, the people, can be treated like debt slaves, milked of their money and slaughtered, and fill up the jails to keep all the pensions for the jail custodians flowing with money. That's what it's about. That said, I want to go to Charlie Grebsky in Florida, where I interviewed him this month, February of 2016. Charlie Grebsky has stumbled across one of the largest scandals, and it's still going on. The FBI hasn't arrested enough corporate CEOs. I think the crux of it comes down to this. Somebody goes into a nursing home for rehabilitation services. The next thing you know, they do some paperwork, go to Medicare and say, this service requires 8 weeks to get William Wagener or whoever back to functioning normally. We need 8 weeks, and the government has a schedule, and they start pumping out the money. According to Charlie, what they do, and they tried to do this to his father, is they get him in there for 2 weeks, and after 2 weeks, move them all out, keep collecting for the next 3, 4, 5, 6, up to 8 weeks, move a whole new bunch in, fill up the beds again. But they're collecting as if they're giving service to these people when they're not. And this is a global organization in medical care. Okay, here we are, February 9th. William Wagener in our near Orlando International Airport with Charlie Grebsky. Okay, Charlie, what happened with your dad?
Well, when you last interviewed me, I was in one hospital here in Orlando, which was the second hospital that we were in after the first one negligently caused him to fall. He had a traumatic spinal cord injury, and then they screwed up numerous times after that, over-medicating him, giving him my medications, leaving him untreated for a blockage in his intestines for over a week, intubating him and sedating him when he shouldn't have been, laying him flat on his back, giving him pneumonia. It was just a nightmare. I actually had to throw the head of the ICU out of the room when he tried to force a tracheotomy on my father, which would have killed my father. But when you interviewed me, I was in another hospital, which was focused on rehab for his pulmonary issues that were caused post-surgery and post the fall. I took him there just for anemia, so he should have been in and out originally in 1 hour. It's now 13 months later, and we only just got home last month. He's learning how to walk again and all that. After I left that hospital, I went to a hospital called Health South, and it was touted as the most innovative, the most advanced, the most, you know, top shelf rehab hospital, where he was going to do physical therapy and occupational therapy to learn how to walk again, to get his arm functional. I mean, at the time, the most he could do was move his fingers like this. You know, wow. He couldn't move his right arm at all.
And so what happened at that hospital?
Well, at that hospital, first they didn't have pulmonary care when he got there that they were supposed to. The person was on vacation, and they actually didn't fill anybody in. And so he relapsed after the 2 months of care we had in the prior hospital. Mm-hmm. And then they tried to immediately send him to a nursing home. And I said, over my dead body, he ain't going to a nursing home. And then every week after that, they kept telling me that Medicare requires him to go to a nursing home. We got to Health South, and at the time, that this was touted as like, it was a brand new facility. It had only been opened in October, and we got there in May. They were supposed to provide him the top quality physical and occupational therapy to get him walking again. I mean, he had a traumatic spinal cord injury and then had to suffer laying in bed for several months because of the other things that went wrong after the surgery, like his pulmonary issues, getting his lungs functional again. When he got there, this hospital was supposed to have a respiratory therapist, and they didn't have anybody on staff the week he got there, so he relapsed while he was suffering pneumonia.
This was in November now?
This is like in May.
Oh, May.
Yeah.
He's been doing a lot of hospital time.
From March till December, I lived with him 24 hours a day from March to September, till December in
okay,
a hospital.
Okay, let me go back a minute. Charlie, what was the hospital where they tried to do the trach on him that he didn't need? Do you remember the name of that hospital?
I certainly do. The first hospital, the doctor came in and tried to do a tracheotomy on my father over my objections when I had power of attorney, and then tried to force it to be done, and I had to throw him out of the room and told the hospital that he's not allowed anywhere back near my father. He was the head of the ICU at that hospital. It's Osceola Regional Hospital in Kissimmee. Osceola Regional.
Osceola Regional Hospital. Who was the doctor trying to do the trach? Do you remember his name?
I do remember his name, but I'm so tired right now. Dr. Hannah. Yeah.
And what was his argument? I got to do this because your power of attorney doesn't mean anything?
He
what?
Said, well, you got to understand, this doctor and another one that was there when he wasn't and running the ICU had the view of in and out, and anybody that's got a problem, sending them to a nursing home, especially if they're old, because they're just going to die eventually. One of them actually talked to me about that. Not this one, not Hannah, the other one. He says, your father's old. They come to the hospital, even if my father came for anemia. He just needed a blood transfusion. That's it, because of a bleeding vessel in his stomach. And it should have been in and out in an hour. But under their negligent care, he fell and hit his head. They put him on a commode, didn't secure the leg, and the leg fell out from under it. He hit his head on the floor and on the bed. They called me and told me that he was getting stitches. Well, I got there and the stitches were in, and he had two major gashes across his right eye. He hit his head on his left side, and then his right eye, the glasses broke and severed his. But he was intubated and sedated, and nobody for 2 days could tell me why. And I immediately noticed that his right upper extremity wasn't working. And despite the fact that he was intubated and sedated, couldn't talk and was sort of out of it, I could get him to give me feedback. One, I could see his right leg is moving, his shoulder's moving, and he's got feeling in his arm. So I said, it's not a stroke, and his nerves aren't completely severed, but something's wrong. And they disagreed with me. They said no. So I had to fight the hospital for 3 days, and then I finally got them to take a look, and sure enough, he had a traumatic spinal cord injury, which caused his spinal cord to be bruised and to swell. And to swell so much that it had no room to expand. And so the limitations of the spinal column were pinching on it and keeping those nerves, particularly the C5 nerves, which innervate the upper right extremity, well, the upper extremities, and in his case, the right side primarily.
Florida, safe state for elderly people?
No. This is a dangerous state. Do not get sick here, anybody. But if you're elderly, you need to get out of Florida. Unless you are extremely wealthy. Because if you're sent to a hospital here, the insurance companies, they'll send you to a nursing home. The nursing homes in this state, other than a few, shouldn't even be licensed. They have no business operating.
So basically healthcare. Slow death camps.
They're not that slow. Most of the people go in there and they wind up dying of pneumonia, which happened to my mother just 3 years ago, which is how I learned the hard way. How bad they were. And I said, there's no way in hell. Over my dead body is what I told the doctor in the ICU about doing the tracheotomy, but I also said that to other hospital officials, which we'll get to, who tried to send him to nursing homes, and that hospital tried to send him to a nursing home as well. Well, the insurance company, the social worker there was very good, and she helped us out a lot, and we got a representative from the hospital we went to that you did the interview with me, Select
right.
Hospital, and they were great, and they treated him great, and they treated us great, and they let us be there as long as we needed, and they got us to the point where his lungs were back in order, he was getting strong enough to begin physical and occupational therapy, and so then they sent us to Health South. But I want to just get back because you'd asked me about Dr. Hanna and Osceola Regional. What I learned, because I lived there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week in the hospitals with my father, except for what I'm going to tell you in a minute, for 1 week period where I was jailed. But I lived there 24 hours in the hospital with him.
For how long?
From March through December.
Wow.
And now I've got him at home, and I stay there 24 hours a day with him.
How old is your dad now?
82. Wow. And he was fully independent before all this.
And what sent him into the hospital in the first place?
Anemia.
Anemia.
That's it.
And it should have been like a two-week treatment and out again.
1 hour.
1 hour?
So all he needed was blood transfusion. That's it.
Did you ever read the China study?
There's lots of China studies. I don't know which one you're talking about.
It's by Thomas Campbell. On page 16, it says the third largest cause of deaths are medical treatments.
Oh, yeah. The worst place you want to be in America today, and definitely in Florida, is in a hospital. You're more likely to get sick and die from what happens in the hospital than the treatment in the hospital. If you have to go, you get in and out as fast as possible.
How would you describe nursing homes in Florida?
Florida? 90% of them have no business being licensed. They are they're waiting rooms to the funeral parlor, and a large percentage of people there die of pneumonia. They just leave the patients laying in the bed. They don't do anything for them. Now there are some nurses and there are some therapists that try, but the administrators really don't care and. Many of the facilities really just they have no business being open. Wow. I did visit one or two when it looked like my father would have to go, and I visited a couple while my mother was. And when I realized when she went back to the hospital, and I realized I have to take control of this because I didn't know. I mean I regret not being my normal self at the time when my mother was going through this, but I was under house arrest. I was very limited in what I could do, and I just didn't know. But what I saw my mother go through, and I saw what happened to her, I knew I would not let that happen again. So when my father went to the hospital, I was very aggressive in my advocacy, and I would not let them do anything with
him. How's he doing at home now that you got him home?
He's doing great. He's learning to walk again.
So he never needed the trick.
Oh, no. If they had given him a tracheotomy, he would have been dead. Now, these ICU doctors would do is come in. First of all, the nurses were great. What they need is about 10 times as many nurses and fewer of these doctors, because these doctors are arrogant. The doctors would come in for 5 minutes in the morning, read the entire unit, there's maybe 40 patients on the unit, read all of their notes about that patient, then walk around with all of their residents, and be like the big shots on TV, you know, with Boston General or all these hospital shows, you know, Mr. Authority, and he would lecture the residents as to what was going on, and he'd say, well, this patient needs this, and this patient needs that, from a five-minute review of paperwork. And in this case, this guy had not seen my father for an entire week, and he'd only seen him when he got back into the ICU after a number of mistakes on their part led him back there, and he was breathing on his own. But what they found out when they so these doctors in the ICU would come in and spend 5 minutes reviewing everybody's case, and then make split decisions, life and death decisions, without any input from the nurses they would never take. They knew it all. They would dictate to their residents, the doctors in training, this is how it's done. The nurses were given no respect. They definitely didn't listen to patients, and certainly not to patients' family members. So this doctor comes in, and my father, who I've been arguing for the past several days because it took me a couple days because he was over-medicated and hallucinating and in extreme pain after the surgery, which didn't make any sense. It turned out he had a blockage in an upper GI, which they knew about and forgot all about and left unattended. And by the time that I got it addressed, there was a huge gas bubble about to explode, plus the blockage. And so this doctor hears that while he's doing the rounds, that my father went into respiratory distress. Well, no, my father, I said, he was on a breathing machine that would help him breathe, and he didn't need it. He was off of it most of the weekend before. This was Monday morning, but he was in such pain. I said, will you try and eat? Because I was worried he wasn't eating, and he needed to keep his strength, but there was no place for it to go. He says, I'll try. But he was in such pain that what he did was he held his breath and went like this, and so the oxygen level dropped real quick because he had been, his pulmonary system was compromised. They had given him pneumonia. They had all sorts of other problems. So this doctor gets the report, comes in later, about 5 hours later, and says, "Well, tomorrow he says, "Today we're going to do a tracheotomy." I said, "No, you're not." He says, "Yes, we are." I said, "No, you're not." I then eventually, in order to get him, I didn't want to do this either, but I let them I tried to stop them. I did stop them at one point, but then I had to give in. In order for another doctor to come in and check the intestinal system, I had to agree to them intubating him again, which I did not want to do. Shouldn't have been done. Third intubation that never should have been done. But he says, if he's not better tomorrow, I'm going to do a tracheotomy. I said, no, we're not even going to talk tracheotomy for another 2 or 3 weeks. The next morning, while we're waiting for someone to actually start the treatment for his intestinal problem, his resident comes in and says, we're going to do the tracheotomy this afternoon. I said, no, you tell your doctor. I told him yesterday, absolutely not. No way. It's not going to happen. 4 hours later, we still haven't gotten the enema that was promised. And my father's dying in pain. And the doctor walks in and he says, I'm doing the tracheotomy now. I said, you are absolutely not doing it. And he argued over me. And then at one point he says, you got to understand, his view was that my father's lungs are not functioning. And he can't breathe on his own, which was not true. And he says he's got pneumonia with an infection, which they only did a culture the day before and still didn't even know what bacteria were there. It turns out there was no bacteria and no infection. But he says to me, he said, let medical professionals do what medical professionals are professional at doing. I said, well, excuse me, I do have a degree in microbiology. He says, well, that's not a medical profession. I said, yeah, but you know what? It does let me know a little bit about microbes and infections and antibiotics, which don't work miracle drugs in 24 hours.
Didn't he notice the gas bubble in his...
He didn't care. He didn't listen. I kept telling him. He didn't listen. He wanted to do the tracheotomy. My father would never have been able to recover from that. So I said, absolutely not. Then he tried to force him. Then when I kicked him out of the room, he went around looking for nurses to back him up, saying that my father agreed to a tracheotomy. And while I was listening, I went to the hospital. The hospital knew, don't let him back in the room, because they already knew that they'd screwed up big time with this. And this was just one step too far. But we finally then got to the place where we did the interview last, which did a wonderful job getting his pulmonary system back together and functioning.
The good hospital was which one?
Select.
Select.
Select Specialty Hospital.
And the bad hospital with Dr. Hanna was?
Osceola Regional.
But then which is a training hospital, isn't it?
Well, yeah, it's the main hospital in this county. It's a private institution.
In which county?
Osceola County.
Osceola County, yeah. Florida.
Right, and right next to Orlando, which is Orange County. But we then went to an even worse hospital, which was touted as the best around. And they had beautiful equipment, and brand new facility. It had only been open since October, and this is now May. The staff were wonderful. The nurses were great. The therapists were great. But what I learned fairly quickly was the place would empty out every 2 weeks. My father kept saying, something's wrong. Why is this place empty? This is a brand new hospital with all these beds. Why is it empty the first couple of days we were there? But I was there for 3.5 months. And I saw every 2 weeks there would be a flow in and then a flow out. And then for 4 days they'd have skeleton crew, nobody there except maybe one or two patients. And then everybody influx in. What they were doing and what they told me several times.
And this hospital, which one was it?
It's called Health South. And it
Health
is
South.
The largest corporation in the world doing rehab medicine. And when it was founded by a guy named Richard M. Scrushy, he was eventually indicted for stealing $4.7 billion in securities fraud, fixing the books to make it look better for the investors and the stock prices.
Sounds like Enron.
It was one. It is. People don't know this case, but it was like Enron at the same time as Enron. It is known as one of the biggest corporate frauds ever. But unlike Enron, this company didn't go bankrupt and was saved and has maintained itself. But it always had a corrupt business model. And that model is this. They will focus on physical therapy and occupational therapy, get mostly Medicare patients. Medicare pays, unlike private insurance. Private insurance, they make deals with every hospital. So every hospital pays, charges different by insurance. That's crazy enough. But Medicare, under Reagan, was changed because they didn't like how much money the hospitals were bilking out of Medicare. So they made a national average system. It went against most of Reaganomics, but this is what they did. They said, we're gonna calculate a national average per condition. That's going to be the base rate. You will be paid, if someone comes in with condition X, you will be paid this much to cure them, to get them back on their feet. This company then, let's say condition X requires on average 8 weeks of care and so much thing. This company is telling everybody, told me several times, and I confronted them on it, and they didn't know who they were dealing with, but they told everybody in the hospital that Medicare only pays for 2 weeks care, and then you have to go either home or to a nursing home, and they decide. And I said, no, what you're doing is you're getting paid for 8 weeks, you're kicking everybody out in two. The 2 weeks already has a profit built in, but you're then taking that 6 weeks as pure profit, then taking that same bed and selling it again, and then selling it again, and selling it 4 or 5 times over. So this is where they're making their huge profits.
God.
And it's massive Medicare fraud. And it needs to be dealt with. This is a scam of scams. And
this is like a scam like on Enron, only bigger.
It's bigger. Bigger than Enron.
Bigger than Enron. And so they're killing people or pushing them out, taking the profit. They may not be healed in 2 weeks. Send them off to a nursing home.
The only people that even could be considered to require only 2 weeks care is someone who spent maybe a couple days in a hospital, not even an elderly person, but the hospital professionals know, medical professionals know, for every day you spend in a hospital, you need like 4 days of rehab just to undo the bed weakness. I'm not talking about overcoming a traumatic spinal cord injury like my father had, central cord syndrome. I mean, like I said, at the time, my father could move his finger that much, couldn't walk, couldn't stand. And yet he was progressing incredibly each week. And they kept reporting no progress. Because this is what happens, that's how Medicare says, okay, if there's no progress, then you can take them off.
And what?
But there is progress.
Again, Charlie, what was the name of the CEO?
The original one was Richard M. Scrushy. The local
CEO. Is he in prison?
Well, he got all of his other execs got nailed and went to federal prison for that scam, and he got a jury to believe because he put on he created in Alabama a Christian television show that he put on during the trial period, and so he says he was the victim. They conned him, but it was the other way around. He then got caught with another securities fraud case about a year later, and then did go to prison. But the CEO at
what year did he finally go to prison?
This is right around Enron, early Enron days. So early mid '90s.
Is he still in prison?
I don't believe he's in prison anymore.
Do you think he bought himself out with the billions of dollars?
Oh, he's got lots of money still.
So he bought his way out, you think?
Well, he did whatever time he did, but I mean, he
got
had
a
money.
Pardon,
he
maybe?
Had money. Well, no, I don't think he got a pardon, but I mean, they only keep white collar criminals in for.
Wasn't Jeb Bush governor of Florida at that time?
Maybe, but this is an Alabama corporation.
But he was operating here in Florida.
He's operating all over the world. All over the world. This today, they are the largest owner worldwide and in America of rehab hospitals, inpatient rehab hospitals.
Wow.
And,
well, thanks
and they're
for
doing
the,
this everywhere.
Thanks for the scoop on that. Now, can you tell me why you got arrested again? Did it have anything to do with that crooked City Hall?
No, it has to do with what I'm telling you right now.
What you're doing right now. So tell me why you were arrested, why are the charges still pending, and what are you doing about it, and what can anybody do in your situation?
Well, and you're welcome to use the video that I took on my cell phone that's on YouTube show.
Okay,
because
thank
I
you.
Videoed the entire arrest. But after I stopped them pushing my father into a nursing home six times and telling me my father was not even close to walking, and then I forced them to change therapists, and in 3 days I had him walking. 3 days. And then every day from there he got better and better and better. So then they said, now that he's walking, now he can go to the nursing home. And I'm like, no. He is here until he has recovered. If you can't do it in the amount of time that Medicare pays you, first of all, Medicare has a system that if in outlier cases, you can get additional funds. But if you can't, the system is designed that it is your incentive to do the job right. And if you don't do the job right, then you lose profit. You're not guaranteed this kind of profit that you're doing. So they called the police and had me trespassed illegally. I was never given a trespass warning or anything. Police storm into my father's room. My father said he felt like the Gestapo had come in. He said that 2 weeks ago in court, which I never heard him say anything like that.
What were you doing 2 weeks ago in court?
I'm still on trial for this from September.
For
trespass, and they charged me with resisting arrest. And you'll see that I neither trespassed nor resisted arrest. In fact, what the police came in, and I'm like, no, I have a right to be here. I'm registered.
This is in which hospital?
Health South.
Supervisor, which I have the right to do, and you have the responsibility to call him because I want to circumstances to the police officer, the supervisor. Secondly, I have actually a right to be here because this is actually our residence right now. And under landlord-tenant law, they have no right to trespass me out of here. Just like they can't trespass me. Because I guarantee I know the law better than you. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Once they allowed us to stay, both of us, to stay here, it was our residence. I'd like to speak to your supervisor. It's all I'm asking.
Health South, which is owned by this worldwide corporation.
Health South Corporation of Alabama, Birmingham, Alabama.
A worldwide rehabilitation hospital services.
Yep. Wow. And their CEO, Jill Jordan, she was the one who was making these decisions. Now, I had 30 minutes before they called the police, I contacted Birmingham headquarters, filed a grievance, and told them that I had just filed a Medicare fraud complaint. And then the police came. They came in while my father and me were sitting in the room. I was sitting on the bed that they supplied me. And I slept in a bed that they provided. They provided me linens and everything. I was residing there.
And they knew it.
And I had thousands of dollars in equipment.
So they knew.
Oh yeah, they knew. And now I had a badge, and I was signed in. And I was allowed to be there. And nobody had ever told me I had to leave until this officer walks in. And I said to the officer, I said, wait a second, no, I'm not trespassing. I have a right to be here. He doesn't want to hear any of that because he's the law. But that's not the way the law works. And I said, well, look, I'm not going to leave without my father. I'm not going to leave my father in their care. I need you to tell them that they need to arrange to have my father moved with me. If I'm going to leave, I'm taking him with me. No, we're not going to do that. I said, I want to talk to your supervisor. You can see this. It all takes place in 3 minutes. I said, I want to talk to your supervisor. No, you're not going to talk to my supervisor. I said, well, fine. I'll tell you what. I'm going to leave like you asked. And now I'm videotaping. And then I'm going to call your supervisor from outside. And the cop hits me in the chest and stops me, detains me, and then says, where's your ID? Well, first of all, if he was there to issue a trespass warning, he has no, that's called a consensual stop. He has no authority to ask for my ID. I have no obligation to give one. He also has no legal authority to be detaining me. And, in fact, because he's acting as a private agent to deliver a trespass, I mean, this is a civil matter. He is not acting as a police officer and has no legal authority to do anything other than issue the warning.
Did you inform him of that?
I tried to. He laughed at my interpretations of the law.
He didn't know you'd gone to law school.
He didn't know anything about me. He didn't care. He knew the law, he thought. But he didn't follow a single part of the law. Despite that, we're still going to trial. Now, when I first got out, when I got to the jail, this cop was so pissed off at what I had done, me challenging him, they threatened to tie me naked to a metal bench and leave me there.
In the hospital?
In the jail.
Oh, in the jail.
But they couldn't because my blood pressure had to be checked first. They had to get permission from the nurse to put me on quote-unquote suicide watch, to tie me naked, to torture me. They made jokes about it. I mean, because I refused to add, their justification is they asked me, do I take illegal drugs? I said, I don't have to answer that.
This was in which county?
Seminole County, Sanford. And the Sanford jail, the jail in Sanford. So they had to take my blood pressure, which was 280 over 150. I said, you need to take me to the emergency room now. The nurse didn't want to tell them and sort of paused. But eventually she said, yeah, you have to. So they took me to the emergency room. Problem was, they refused to allow me to call my attorney. They refused to allow me to call a bond. They refused to allow me to call anybody. So nobody knew I was arrested. Nobody knew I was in the hospital. And nobody knew my father was abandoned in a hospital where he was being mistreated. And as I predicted, when I was gone, they coerced him twice to sign documents to release him to a nursing home, which I rescinded the minute I got out. But it took me seven days to get out. Then I had to spend two more days in jail because after I got out, it took me 7 days to get to a bond hearing because I was in a cell in a dungeon, locked away. They wouldn't let me use the phone to call my lawyer. They wouldn't let me use the phone to call a bonds person. When I did get bond granted by the judge, they thought they had me on violation of probation. By the way, because of this, the probation that I was on for all these years that was supposed to go on in the future was rescinded early, terminated by the court in Alachua County because they knew the abuses were getting out of control. So Alachua County, they tried to violate me on probation and send me to prison for this arrest. Alachua County not only threw that case out, but then ended my terminated the probation from that 2007.
In a separate hearing. How long did that take after they first tried to rescind your probation?
That went to court within a month, and within a month, that hearing took about 5 minutes. Even the prosecutor said, yes, judge, terminate the probation, and no, judge, we don't want to prosecute this case. But the prosecutor...
The judge upset when the prosecutor said that?
No. The judge was impressed that the prosecutor said that. But the problem is the same case, because we showed the judge the video, and the judge says there's no crime, there's no offense. Clearly, there is no offense on the video. But this judge in Seminole County hasn't seen the video, but the prosecutor refuses to let it go. Now, I had to turn myself, after I got out of 7 days, I got out on a bond, and that took a lot, and I was in...
How much was the bond?
Oh, I got a recognizance on one and $1,000 on the other.
So you had to post $100 cash.
It was almost $200, which it turned out to be. But yeah.
Do you remember the name of this cop that hit you in the chest?
His name is Garner.
Are you suing him? Is he named a defendant in your lawsuit yet?
I haven't filed a lawsuit yet, but I intend to.
How long has it been since that happened?
That happened in September. But my first priority was getting my father home.
Yeah, so it's been 5 months. Now you got your father home.
Now I got to put an end to this trial, which is set for jury selection on the 22nd.
Of this month?
Yeah, although we're going to depose the officer Garner tomorrow. And there's no basis. This case should not go forward. Now, when I went to court, I had to turn myself in again after I bonded out because they never processed my bond. And so I had to go to Alachua County, turn myself in, spend a night and a day in Alachua County to get bonded out again. Alachua County was very helpful and cooperative, but I had to do it. So I spent 9 days in jail while my father was languishing and being abused in this hospital. And I stopped them doing what they were trying to do with him. I went ballistic on the people with Medicare, and I said, no, he did not voluntarily sign those documents. He was coerced. And that's a problem. That's fraud. That's elder abuse. That's a real problem. But I then got him to the VA hospital and the spinal cord clinic in Tampa. And everything's been great since then. But with me, I'm still on trial. When I went before the court on the first day, for the first time after I got out of jail, the judge didn't even look up. Your Honor, the prosecutor's there. I'm there, standing there. The judge says, "Prosecutor, what's the deal you offer?" They said, "Time served, no fine, just the amount of time I did in jail. I go home." I said, "No." I said, "I'm innocent. You are going to put this to trial, or you're going to drop the case. No time served. Nothing about I concede that I was guilty." So that was several months ago.
Did that upset the judge?
The judge wasn't happy about that. The judge didn't like when I said I'm going to represent myself either. I said, well, then you appoint a public defender to assist me.
And did he appoint a public defender pretender?
And I then I fired the public defender.
How soon?
It took me about a month and a half to fire the public defender. What? They refused to do what I told them to do, and they demanded I take deals. And I said, look, I said, I was offered a deal.
Charlie, it appears you've been put through a lot of trauma here, just trying to save your father.
Yeah, and it's had a real impact on my health.
All right, we're back here in the studio. That was Charlie Grubbsky this month, 2016, February, explaining why you don't want to be an elderly person stuck into a nursing home in the state of Florida. It could be your death sentence. Doing tracheotomies you don't need and ignoring the real ailments you have. Charlie did get his father out. He's preparing to sue, as you can imagine, and he has some law school training, and he's filed a lot of lawsuits before, and he's forced them to back away. I think Charlie Grubbsky will win. Now I want to take you to the other extreme end of the United States of these unhappy Americans, to the state of Oregon, and Sheriff Mack has a comment. This is a former sheriff who knows what it is to carry the authority of the sheriff's badge and do his duty. And he's got something, I'm not going to say it, I'm going to let Sheriff Mack say it, about these ranchers that are wrongfully imprisoned by our federal criminals under the BLM cloak, where they're stealing the land from the private owners and destroying their right to public use. Take it, Sheriff Mack.
I told Ammon so. But Ammon Bundy is a good friend of mine. He is a good person. He is a good man. And you talk to anybody who knows him, they'll tell you the same. Well, I guess I gave you the nutshell.
Yes, that is true. But you know, if you said that people were singing Amazing Grace, that's not really what domestic terrorists, so-called, from the media would do, right? I mean, that's sounds like that sounds dangerous.
The militia people be saying Amazing Grace. We sang it as radical as we possibly could.
Well, I'm glad you said that.
Let me tell you one thing, Josh, okay? I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Go ahead.
But let me tell you this. I've already talked to sheriffs in Arizona. I've talked to sheriffs in Utah, talked to sheriffs in Texas, and talked to sheriffs in Florida. You know that those sheriffs in every one of those states, and not all sheriffs, but some of them, have cited numerous incidents to me. And when I was sheriff, I had the same thing happen, that the federal government, usually the Forest Service or the BLM, does their own controlled burnings just like the Hammonds did, and the wind picks up, and they burn the half the side of our Mount Graham in Graham County where I was sheriff. And nobody got fired, and nobody got charged with arson, and nobody paid any fines, and these people are never charged with terrorist acts, and yet what happens? They do it to a 73-year-old man who is nothing but a law-abiding, good, honest American citizen. And this is what our government does, and it's ruthless, and it's about as corrupt as it could possibly be. And every sheriff now in this country needs to start filing charges against federal officials who do the same thing and charge those people with domestic terrorism and arson and put them in prison just like they did the Hammonds.
And that's a call to action right now. And I totally understand what Ammon Bundy has done, the frustration of this tyranny. I've been talking to a lot of people. A lot of people are afraid for the safety of them in Oregon because they feel that something may happen. Yeah. Or there may be another Waco. This may be turn into another Waco. And there's even speculation that, you know, there might be, you know, people in there to instigate certain things to trigger some type of conflict. What's your thoughts on that? Are you afraid for the Bundys and the other patriotic Americans that are there?
Yeah, and I'm not sure who all's in there, and I don't believe Ammon knows who's all in there.
Right.
I don't believe he knows everybody in there well enough to risk his life for them and put his life in their hands, and I think he's done that. And yes,
I am extremely afraid for Hammond and his two brothers. I know his brother Ryan. I don't know Mel very well. I know his father and his mother pretty well. But I'm really fearful for his life. And you never know what this corrupt government's going to do. If they can do it to Hammonds, and they can do it to Waco and Ruby Ridge and other places, they will do it again. And their MO and their history is very sordid and corrupt and non-caring. And whatever they have to do to save face, they're going to do. And the scary thing I fear also is that there's just no way that the federal government can allow Hammond or and the other people therein to win this. They can't allow him to have a victory on this. Ammon Bundy and his family had a huge victory back a year and a half ago in Bunkerville, Nevada. And they barely escaped with their lives at that time. The order to kill the protesters and the Bundys was given. I know it was given. And a deputy sheriff stopped it. And I'm going to tell you, I got to do a shout out for Lou Dobbs, because this past Monday night, Lou Dobbs did a fantastic story about this, and he knocked it out of the park, and he was exactly correct. And you know what he said is the real problem here? He says, we all know the federal government's corrupt. We know they're going to do things like this. The elected officials in Oregon should have stopped it.
Right.
And the sheriff of Harney County should have stopped this, and the county commissioners and the county attorney and the senators and congressmen from Oregon and others should have stepped up, the governor, and they should have made sure that this innocent family did not have their rights violated by the federal government. And for anybody to think that we can't stand for freedom and stop a government from doing these sort of things needs to read the Declaration of Independence, because this is exactly what we should be stopping. And I understand the frustration that Ammon Bundy has experienced, and I feel the same way he does. But I just don't agree with this tactic. I don't think it can win. And I fear for his family and himself.
What should the grassroots people all over this nation, what can they do to try to demand the release of the Hammonds?
One thing, I want you to call your sheriff and demand that he charge any federal official with the same crimes that the Hammonds got. And then call all public officials, the governor's office, and any elected officials that you know in Oregon, especially the sheriff, and encourage him to do his job and say, look, your job is to protect people from all enemies, both foreign and domestic. So how about all criminals, foreign and domestic? And to have a sheriff say, oh yeah, well, I'll protect you from street criminals and rapists and murderers, but I won't protect you from any crime the federal government commits. That doesn't make any sense at all. To whom can the people turn for peace, safety, and liberty when government becomes out of control and corrupt? If it's not your local officials, and especially your sheriff, who's sworn oath in God's name to uphold and defend the Constitution, where else can we go? And that's exactly what our CSPOA does. And we would love people to get behind us there, too. Become a member of the CSPOA at CSPOA.org and help us in this battle for freedom. And this still is, our solution is still effective and peaceful. And that's why we want you on board.
Yes, and we will link to your great organization that's really inspiring people and really makes people aware of how important it is to elect a sheriff that believes in the Constitution will protect their rights, especially against a federal government. And I appreciate so much what you do in the movement that you've started across this nation. We just need to get the word out. Of course, the media won't, mainstream media won't report on that. And it's sad that they depict patriotic Americans that just want the Bill of Rights to be upheld, that they depict those type of people as domestic terrorists. Shame, but we appreciate your work, Sheriff.
And since that was taped, since Sheriff Mack came out and called them what they are, federal criminals, there are other sheriffs who agree the federal government is illegally operating on public land and doing crimes against ranchers and farmers who grow food for us. How insane is this? Call your Congress critter. Tell him you want the Hammonds released immediately. Congress can do that. They can impeach the federal judge that has done these things if they had a backbone. But I think there's an agenda going on, and the lawyers facilitated. What did Dennis Schultke say about lawyers? What is the difference between a lawyer and a liar? The pronunciation. I love this Dennis Schultke's book. I love this, Attorneys Above the Law. We need to put all these attorneys in jail. What do honest lawyers and UFOs have in common? You always hear about them, but you never see them. You just gotta love this book. He's got line after line of these things. They're just great. Just great. I like this one. What difference between a shame and a pity? A busload of lawyers going over a cliff and there are no survivors. That's known as a pity. If there were any empty seats, that's a shame. You just gotta love this guy. Anyway, I want to ease up now before we take you to Misselbach, Austria, to hear people singing about Michael Jackson and singing his songs. I want to let you look at the manatees floating around on manatee territory near a power plant in Florida, where the manatees actually thrive. There's the power plant, and it keeps the water warmer. And as the water's warmer, the manatees thrive there. The power plant actually shelters these manatees from the cold waters that they're getting right now in the Gulf. And you can see them swimming. And we were lucky enough while we were there. I mean, this was just this month, February. They had taken a manatee in that it got chopped up and injured, and they healed him in a manatee reserve. And they released him while we were there. I don't think we're going to have time to see that. But I just wanted to share this with you. These are such gentle, beautiful mammals swimming there. They're like waterborne elephants. Well, I'm William Wagner for Take Back America. We need you to call your Congress critter, whoever it is, wherever you are. Call, find out who your Congress critter is, as most of you don't know. Call them and say, I want the Hammonds, father and son, Dwayne and Stephen, released from federal prison, or that judge impeached. This is a crime. Sheriff Mack sees it as a crime. Other sheriffs see it as a crime. We need to put the BLM back in the bottle and then toss the bottle into a no man's land and forget them. I'm William Wagner. That's my opinion. Now I'd like to take you to a faraway land high in the mountains of Austria. In a little town about 1.5-2 hours drive from Vienna, Austria, where they put up a new statue of Michael Jackson, and yours truly, William Wagner, was there, and I did get to meet Lady Habsburg. You'll see her at the end of this. She's married to Lord Habsburg, and those are the royal family of the Austrian-Hungarian dynasty. Here's the singers at the dedication of the new Michael Jackson statue there. Here's a shoe of some of the shops. And yes, it was raining.
This is it. I mean, this is really it. This is the final. This is
and
the
reason
final
the language sounds
call.
Because they're speaking in German, but they sing in English. And they sing Michael Jackson's
Michael Jackson Denkmals in Österreich. Hier ist Martina Kainz.
Also ich möchte mich bedanken bei euch, dass alle so gekommen seid, auch wenn es regnet, wie immer. Bei mir ist das immer so, bei mir regnet es dauernd. Ist gemein, ja. Nächstes Mal machen wir das in der Wüste, passt wieder. So, ich möchte mich auch bedanken bei unseren Sponsoren, die das möglich gemacht haben, vor allem bei den Fans und bei meinem Mann, dem Hundeschweiger. Ja, genau. Dann beim Rame Abazai, da hinten, da können Sie dann was trinken und essen. Der hat den Sockel genau, den ganzen Sockel für uns gebaut, die Statue aufgestellt, alles gratis, super. Rame, super. Da können wir noch eine Disco, gell? Was? Alle können essen zum Rame, gell?
Ja,
dann haben wir noch Feuerwerk heute, das wert halt nichts, wir dürfen nichts schießen, weil es regnet. Das kann in die Hose gehen, das ist vielleicht nicht so ideal. Dann haben wir Animal Experts. Das ist eine Firma, die uns auch die Bühne gesponsert hat. Und was haben wir noch? Euch alle, die was uns Spende geleistet haben. Und ja, ich freue mich für alles, was gemacht habt. Ich freue mich, dass alle da seid. Und ich freue mich für meinen Moderator, den ich jetzt erlösen kann. Wo ist der? Da, genau. Hallo.
Servus.
Servus.
Ewald Wurzinger, mein Name, Reporter bei Radio Wien, und es ist mir eine Ehre, hier heute zu stehen. Und ich habe vorher keinen Applaus gehört. Bitte um einen Riesenapplaus für Martina Kainz, die in den letzten 2,5 Jahren hier geschuftet hat. Er ist und bleibt der King of Pop, das Idol vieler, und seit heute ist Michael Jackson ein Mistelbacher und ja mehr oder weniger das vierte Kind von Martina Kainz. 2,5 Jahre Wehen sind jetzt nicht unbedingt nett, oder?
Nein, aber jetzt sollte die Alimente, was heißt Kind?
Ja, die Sponsoren, das hast du ja auch schon. Martina Kainz hat unermüdlich die letzten 2,5 Jahre an diesem Event, an dem Denkmal heute hier gearbeitet und sage und schreibe 13 Klammer auf, Rufzeichen, Klammer zu, Programmpunkte organisiert. Hinter mir stehen schon die Mädels und Mädels, Burschen und der Bursch vom Barkeep und HLW-Chor Mistelbach, die gleich 2 Nummern zum Besten geben werden. Nonna, Michael Jackson Nummern, und da ist jetzt irgendwo dahinter die Mercedes Corvette, sie heißt wirklich so. Lüfte das Geheimnis, was gibt's jetzt?
Ja, also als erstes wird die Barkeep und HLW Heal the World singen und nachher nur der HLW-Chor Will You Be There.
Super, Applaus gibt's dann auch. Martina, möchtest du noch irgendwas sagen?
Vielleicht später. Lass mal die Mädels einmal singen.
Passt. Großer, dicker, fetter Applaus für den Barkeep und HLW-Chor Mistelbach.
And I know.
Wochenlang haben Sie sich vorbereitet auf den heutigen Abend und dann haben Sie gleich die Eröffnungsshow bekommen. That was it. Thank you. That was it ist auch schon das Stichwort unseres nächsten Programmpunktes. 2009 hat Martin Svitek, ein slowakischer Michael Jackson-Imitator, seine Show That Was It gegründet und heute ist er hier gemeinsam mit seinen beiden Damen Martina und Susanna. Wird er uns 17 Minuten performen, natürlich Michael Jackson Songs und Step-Dance. Hier ist Martin Svitek. Und ich sage einfach die Eltern, Martina. Hello. What will you present to show us? What is the idea behind your show, behind the imitation? You can answer.
I'm